beautiful day in Tampa Bay. Temperature around 70 as we approach game time. And the Buccaneers, after 24 consecutive losses, look for victory number one against the Atlanta Falcons, still alive in the NFC West at 5-5. Hi, everybody. I'm Bob Costas, along with Emerson Boozer. And Emerson, Gary Huff is back off the injury list for Tampa Bay, and Steve Bartkowski just trying to get things back together, playing his fourth game after returning from knee surgery.
Tampa is very excited about getting Gary Huff back because they feel that when they have Gary Huff in the ballgame, he puts more points on the board, even though they haven't done that well. But with Atlanta, with Bartkowski, he hasn't done that well, even though he's been back four times this year since his injury. They're hoping to put more points on the board. So both clubs have not had the big scoring punches they need, and they're looking for it today.
Of course, with that 5-5 record, Atlanta is just two games back of Los Angeles in the NFC West. The Rams have a tough remaining schedule, beginning with Cleveland today, and the Falcons do have one more head-to-head shot at Los Angeles in Los Angeles, so just about anything could conceivably happen. 52, so Steve Bartkowski and the Falcons go to work, first and 10, from their own 32.
First and 10 for Atlanta on the 32.
The offensive line of the Falcons, Thielman and Bryant, are both rookies. Their numbers 1 and 2 draft choices. Van Note, the veteran of the group at center. Jenkins and Francis, the wide receivers. The excellent veteran tight end, Jim Mitchell. Standback and Thompson are Bartkowski's running backs. Speaking of that Buck defense, they play the 3-4. Council Rudolph and Leroy Selmon at the ends. And the nose man, the very fine Dave Pear. Lewis and Harris, both are rookies on the outside. And Dewey Selmon and Richard Wood, second and third year men respectively, as the inside linebackers. And there's their secondary. White and Washington, the corners. Brown and Cotney, the safeties. Second down play. And Dave Pear is all over Haskell Standback. You'll hear Pear's name frequently today, Emerson. He seems to be in on almost every play. Concerned, completed only 41%. They go with the draw and come up short of the first down as Standback is brought down by a combination of inside linebacker Dewey Selmon, 61, and the aforementioned Dave Pear, number 76. So we see right off the bat a reluctance on Atlanta's part to put the ball in the air.
Better distance, both having hit in the 70s this year, Bob.
That was a 51-yard kick by John James. A look at the offensive line. Revis, Winans, Rysik, Medlin, and Carlton. Isaac Hagans and Morris Owens, the wide receivers, with Knopfziger at the tight end. And the two USC products, Davis and Bell, the running backs behind Gary Huff, and that was Davis. Brought down for very nearly no gain, maybe a pickup of one. Humphrey, the best known, of course. Bailey, Lewis, and Merrow alongside him. Excellent young group of linebackers. Pennywell, Ortega, and Brazina. Actually, Brazina, not too young, a 10-year veteran. Lawrence, Brown, Easterling in the secondary. And Rick Bias, the other man, whose name somehow didn't get on the screen. A little flip to Ricky Bell. Out across the 15, short of the first down. So Huff has been the man most capable of moving their offense. His first throw of the game is intercepted. Intercepted by Roland Lawrence. That is his sixth interception of the year. And at this point, he leads the NFC.
I don't think Mr. Huff has read the articles on Roland Lawrence here. He steps in, threw the ball a little bit short, I think. Handball at all in this area.
Standback goes out. Billy Ray Pritchett now alongside Thompson in the backfield. And this is Pritchett getting the call and barreling straight ahead.
Billy Pritchett with the ball.
Down near the 15-yard line. Number one. On third and one, two tight ends are in, and the quarterback sneak appears to have gotten them the first down. This year, he has had 8 passes intercepted. A flip to Standback. Standback looking for the 1-yard line, which is where he had to go for the first down, but he comes up way short of that. And we're going to see Freddie Steinfurt for a field goal attempt.
It's a simple swing pattern outside, hoping to get his running back to the outside and get some running room, but it just didn't work against the stingy Tampa Bay defense.
Kim McQuilkin, number 11. And he drills this one through there. And Atlanta is on the board first, leading 3-0, as Steinfurt kicks his fifth field goal in 6 attempts as a member of the Atlanta Ball Club. 8 minutes and 11 seconds to play in the first quarter at Tampa, and the Falcons are out in front. And the Buccaneers deep in their own territory. They run out of the eye. First man through, Ricky Bell. And Bell with good yardage. Out to about the 17 or 18 yard line. Week in Detroit against the Lions, his first NFL score. Bell again. First down for Tampa Bay, out to the 21. Up through, his pass was intercepted, and that led to an Atlanta field goal. Now he's under the gun. He will be sacked, and he loses the football. Looked like Ricky Bell jumped on it. And I believe it will be Tampa Bay ball. Yes, it will.
Quarterback, especially when he's been out for a while.
Dave Green, in a situation to which he has become accustomed, punting out of his own end zone. He is a good kicker, averaging better than 40 yards a kick. This one will be fair caught at about the 41-yard line by Billy Rickman.
Can't get any better.
This is Bartkowski's third year in the NFL, but because of the various injuries he's sustained, he's had scarcely more experience than a rookie. Third down play. Over the middle, and he's got his tight end, Jim Mitchell. And Mitchell is a guy accustomed to making clutch catches, and he gives Atlanta a first down there to keep this drive alive. Second down and about eight. Stand back trying to go outside. Slipping a tackle and moving inside the 15. Good play, good gain for stand back.
Stand back could have gotten a little bit more out of that play.
Humphrey in there now. Woody Thompson, their biggest back, has the first down. Stand back into the lineup in place of Esposito, who almost had the touchdown pass on the last play. Bartkowski looking for six. Jenkins caught the ball, and we may have a pass interference call. Jenkins was out of the end zone, so it won't be a touchdown, but it will be a first down for Atlanta at the one.
The call is justified. Ball was put right on the money by Bartkowski to Francis, and pushed in the back. Notice here, number 45 coming over, Josh White. Getting a hand in the back. Had he not pushed,
in the end zone,
would have had 6 points.
First down on the 1 yard line
for the Falcons. Stand back. Did he get there? Yes, he did. Touchdown, Atlanta. Haskell stand back. His third touchdown of the year.
Now, this was simply good blocking. Fieldman, Bryant, Mitchell, and Thompson, they all get the blocks. All Standback has to do is get up and over, and that they did.
Good sells with a 10-0 cushion. We're in the final minute of quarter number one. Bartkowski under the gun. Cuckoo threw that one into a crowd, and Council Rudolph almost had a surprise interception. Rudolph, number 78, a decathlon of strength. And it's the refrigerator race. Each competitor will race with a 400-pound refrigerator strapped to his back and try to cover 40 yards in the fastest time. Ricky Bell covered something less than 40 yards on that play as he's dumped for a loss.
Look at Mr. Brazina come in here. Got past his blocker. Somebody had to blow an assignment.
Put it in the air. From the 27. All kinds of trouble. Brazina is after him as Huff throws on the run. Incomplete, and Tampa Bay will have to punt.
Right in on that football.
Second down, eight. Huff near the goal line. Gets it away as he is being sacked, and that was a mistake. Ralph Ortega with the interception. And Ortega sets Atlanta up again. A very bad mistake on the part of Gary Huff.
Now listen to this. If you cannot throw the football standing back in the pocket, what makes Mr. Huff believe that he can throw the ball almost in the prone position? He's almost on the ground. And here comes the football. I don't know what made him believe that he could get it off.
And Ralph Ortega, the only man within 10 yards of it. And the three-year veteran from Florida, playing perhaps in front of some of his old friends here at Tampa Bay today. 3 years ago. But injuries have delayed his progress. Under pressure. He is sacked in a loose football.
Aha.
Tampa Bay has it.
Well, that time Tampa Bay made his own break. Coming in on the blitz. Drawing the football loose. A blitz on the left side of your screen. I can't see the number of the blitzer.
Looks like Paul Harris from his linebacker spot made the hit, and Council Rudolph, number 78, the veteran, made the fumble recovery. Throws to Scott Dierking for 5 yards, and that game is tied in the second quarter. third down four for Gary Huff and the Buccaneers. Incomplete, they'll have to punt, but penalty marker is down. And perhaps that's a little too soon. It might be pass interference, and that'll give them a first down. 4:14 to play in the half. Huff pitches to Carter. Carter across midfield. Carter moving down the sidelines for the best game of the day for Tampa Bay. Robert Pennywell finally came over to make the stop. They're in the second quarter. Huff back to throw. Over the middle, it's picked off by Pennywell. Pennywell laterals the ball to Ray Brown. And Brown fumbles it. And who picked it up? Like the Keystone Cops out there, Greg Brezina, number 50, came up with it. Three different Falcons handled the ball. Its first real drive of the day, but that was cut off when Pennywell intercepted. Draw play, stand back. Haskell stand back. Rambling inside the 35-yard line of Tampa Bay. Staff, Atlanta trying to pad their lead. Haskell stand back. Jumping over people and picking up another good gain. Got about eight on the play. Down around the 27-yard line.
Hoping that somebody says, hey, you can't carry the ball all day like that.
Wachowski to the air, pumping and being sacked.
Mr. Yum-Yum, Leroy Selmon, you don't go out to this side of the field pumping the football because he is as tough as any defensive end in the business. Watch number 63 on the right side of your screen come into the picture. Wachowski tries to find room to throw the ball. Leroy just yummed him. Look at it again. This is what you call yumming on a quarterback.
This is the eighth sack of the year. Look out. Leroy again. Two plays in a row. Leroy Selmon has come through to sack Steve Wachowski.
Now, this was not a yum. This is like crunching peanut brittle. Even though you hate to see the quarterback get hit like this from the blind side. But that's a crunch. And he looks around front. He could have stuck the helmet in the back, but Leroy comes around looking for the football. He wants to create a fumble. Notice where he puts his head. Gets it around front.
27 wins and only 40 losses. He went to 9 different bowl games. A man accustomed to winning. Can't be too happy losing 24 consecutive games. But except for occasional outbursts, he has kept his good humor about it. And he said this week that if Tampa Bay doesn't win this one, he's going to show up on the sidelines next week nude because he's... Tampa Bay trailing the Atlanta Falcons 10-0 here. And really, except for a drive in the closing minutes of the second quarter, the Buccaneers have not been able to mount any offense at all. As you can see, they have 3 first downs to their credit. The Falcons with 8. The Falcons with just about double the rushing yardage, and there's a telling stat, M. -5 yards passing for Tampa Bay. If he can get behind somebody and Huff can get it to him, a threat to break one. Huff throwing on first down. He's got his man. It's Morris Owens with the catch. He's in there early in the year before sustaining some injured ribs. Back in as a starter today for the first time in more than a month. This flip to DeBose brings him into Atlanta territory. DeBose very close to a first down.
Boy, the new champion there. He plays almost a controlled type of defensive line.
Third and less than a yard. Huff keeps it. They've got the first down. Number one quarterback for Tampa Bay, if he was healthy. He sustained a knee injury in preseason, and that put him on the shelf for the rest of the year. Protection breaking down, and Huff scrambling. Out of bounds he goes, obviously way short of the first down, and Dave Green will come in to punt again. Steve Bartkowski. Atlanta still with that 10-0 lead. Haskell stand back. For a gain of 5, out to 25. 7-6, that's early in the second quarter. Stand back on 3rd and 3. First down for Atlanta. We'll look at stand back and that first down run again. 1st and 10 for Bartkowski in Atlanta. Quick drop and throw, and he's got his man. Wallace Francis with the catch. Francis has been spending most of his time this afternoon along the sidelines. Two of McKay's starting linebackers, David Lewis and Richard Wood, played for him at USC. And of course, his two top running backs, Davis and Bell were all-time Trojan greats. Woody Thompson once again. Dave Hare wraps his arms around him and brings him down. Hare is one of the strongest men in the NFL. The Tampa 48, speaking of Hare, he was Tampa Bay's MVP in 1976. Thompson looking for three and not finding it. Richard Wood hit him first. Paul Harris got to him second. Afternoon for Gary Huff. Protection breaks down and down goes Huff. Penalty marker on the play. Jeff Merrow credited with the sack. The 45 of Tampa Bay. It'll be good field position again for the Falcons. A fumble on it. Carl Farmer fumbled the ball, and Tampa Bay scrambling after it. They do not have it.
This is the way it opened in the first half, causing Atlanta to get that first field goal.
And then it did go out of bounds, although McCartney, number 56, ended up on top of the ball. Jim Mitchell, but that did not fool Dave Lewis, the rookie linebacker, at all, and he dumps Mitchell.
Dave played it extremely well. He stepped across, not really chasing. Dave plays this thing almost like a veteran here. He comes down the line of scrimmage rather than go chasing at the play action in the other direction. With
Markowski with the play action pass. He's got time, and he's got his man over the middle. Complete to Alfred Jenkins. First and 10 from the 22, Woody Thompson. Down to around the 17-yard line. Second down play. Thompson through a gaping hole.
Brown had to come up and save a possible touchdown. Woody Thompson got rolling.
Will stand back down to about the four as Atlanta marches toward a touchdown, which will put them in front 16-0. Thompson and stand back out of that eye. Stand back gets the call again, pushes it down close to the goal line. And a yard is needed. Stand back, touchdown, they say. They say he broke the plane of the goal line, and obviously the Buccaneers do not agree. Council Rudolph and Dave Lewis jawing with the officials, and with 1:34 to play in the third quarter at Tampa Bay, as we look at that disputed touchdown again, 17-0, the Falcons lead it. Isaac Higgins near the goal line, 25-30, fumbles the football, white shirts all around it. Atlanta football.
Costly mistake after mistake.
Here. They trail here 17-0 with a minute to play in the third quarter. Thompson's fumble comes after the whistle, which disappoints David Lewis. And Rams with a two-game Western Division lead in the NFC over these Atlanta Falcons. Markowski needs 10 yards. Off the hands of a Tampa Bay defender and incomplete. Wilkin is kneeling at the 41. This is a 51-yard attempt by Freddie Steinfort, which was partially blocked.
Looks like it was somebody in the middle of the line. Can't tell exactly who got a hand on it, but it looked like it was Leroy Selmon.
Looked like it. Number 63 was up there higher than anybody else, really. Carter gives the ball to Ragsdale on a reverse. Ragsdale coming around the left side. Runs into his own man, keeps his footing. Third down, two. Jimmy DuBose stops short of the first down.
Defense number 87, offside. First down.
Couldn't jam. First and 10 from the 46. Hedberg under pressure. Lights out time. Jeff Merrow applying the finishing touches. From the Buck 39. Under the gun again as he gets this one off. It is intercepted by Ray Easterling. Easterling sauntering up the sideline. And down he goes around the 25 of Tampa Bay. Gronkowski throwing on second and eight. Alfred Jenkins making the catch. And brought down none too gently by Mike Washington. Weakest offensive team in the league, and in terms of points allowed, Atlanta the strongest defensive team in the league. So the handwriting was on the wall when this one began. But that Tampa Bay defense continues to battle. They're a tenacious group for Atlanta. Started in Tampa Bay territory. They have not moved any great distances against this Tampa Bay defense.
That's the way you want to start. If you've got to start across that 50-yard line, you know then psychologically you don't have that far to carry.
John James gets off his punt. Bounces at the 10, down to the 5, and they're going to down it at the 1-yard line. Typical John James effort. Was almost on the goal line. Edwards better not step out of that end zone. He's got them out of trouble with a peg to John McKay. The coach's son, J.K. McKay, makes the catch. The young boy.
Balmwina,
you got it. He says it's his job to come into the game and freak out the center. That time it was Claude Humphrey freaking out Randy Hedberg. There's a flag down on this play. Let's
defense,
listen to Bob Fred.
Number 32 offside, third down.
Randy Hedberg, tiny Minot State College. Look at the pressure, even on that play, and Louis Carter couldn't hold on. It would have been a first down. December 31st, Stanford goes against LSU with Charles Alexander. LSU's Alexander gained over 230 yards last night in a big win over Wyoming. So, some excellent action. Number 26 is in the backfield now with Haskell Standback. Standback carrying, but not for the first down. And Atlanta will win here. It'll still be a two-game edge for the Rams in the NFC West. Standback diving in an attempt to get the first down. Like Doug Williams from Grambling or Matt Cavanaugh from Pittsburgh, has to be in the mind of John McKay with that number one draft choice coming up.
Certainly, if it's not a quarterback, it should be a tight end, because right now Tampa doesn't have that quality tight end that can give you the strong blocking to get inside. One big change, though, Dave Pierce not the nose man as Bill Kohler was there. He got shut off as they blocked down on him. And Esposito, he's off and running. Hasn't played that much this year.
And that is he carrying the ball. Nice game by the rookie. Season, if they can get a touchdown here, they'll exceed that total. Esposito, hello. Fourth down and 3. Steinfurt is in to attempt the field goal, which is no good. It hooked off wide to the right. And so the Falcons must be content to sit on that 17-0 lead with 5 minutes and 36 seconds to play in the ball game. On second and 10. The pitch is back to Carter. They try that reverse again. This is Ragsdale coming around. This play works again. Ragsdale out near the 40-yard line. Bumped out at about the 39. They need 10 or they'll have to give the football up. Edberg with better protection this time. His pass batted in the air by Ray Brown and it falls incomplete. He was trying to hit Knopfseger, his tight end. Sandra of LSU undoubtedly will receive some support. Dave Green punting. And it's Billy Rickman with a good return. Rickman out near midfield before being tripped up. But everybody knows he is capable of being once he gets on track. Once his injuries have completely healed.
There are a number of things that can slow a quarterback down, and I've seen...
Really, he's never had a chance to realize his full potential, but still a young player. It may come yet. Sir Cedric McIntyre on the carry, and Bill Kohler on the stop. Nick Wallace, Morley Safer, and Dan Rather on CBS. 60 minutes. Mike Esposito. Atlanta plays at home next week against New England as McIntyre busts over the right side for some good yardage. Strapped to the backs of the competitors in the world's strongest men competition, and they'll try to race 40 yards. McIntyre trying to race into the end zone, but pulled down from behind. Lost to San Francisco. They scored 23, their most ever, in a 30-23 loss to Seattle. So Cedric McIntyre getting the call here would represent their top point production of the season. McIntyre around the left side, struggling down close to the first down. And they may have to measure. Mike Washington, 29, set by the Chicago Cardinals back in the 40s. On a fourth down and less than one, it's Bartkowski on the sneak. The officials stop the clock, at least momentarily, while they untangle things. This one comes to an end. Atlanta got the last touchdown in the third quarter when Isaac Higgins fumbled on an attempted run back. The ball popped into the hands of an Atlanta player. They drove home from there with standback scoring from the one. Steinfurt added the extra point, and from that point on, they just played out the string, with the Falcons posting a 17-0 victory, improving their record to 6-5, dropping Tampa Bay and their coach, John McKay, whom you see walking off, to 0-11 this year, and 0-25 over 2 years in the NFL. Now let's go down on the field and pick up Emerson Boozer, who has Claude Humphrey, the outstanding defensive lineman of the Atlanta Falcons, with him. Em?
Thank you, Bob. Certainly, Claude Humphrey is one of the standout defensive ends for the last 9-10 years, but some time ago, 2 years ago to be exact, he suffered a dreadful knee injury. But Claude, from today's action, it appears as though, and last year, some 18 sacks individually, and today's performance, it appears as though you've erased totally that knee from your mind.
Well, I don't think about it. I mean, it was an injury. You get injuries during the course of the game, and you get all kind of injuries. It was a knee injury, and it was an injury, and I was fortunate enough to have some good people working with me, Jerry Ray, our trainer, and Freddie Swocker, who's now with the San Francisco 49ers. Those people worked with me real good and diligently, and I kicked at Emerson. It's gone now. I don't even think about it.
Claude, let's take you back a week in time, not overlooking today's ballgame, but you lost a very crucial game to the New Orleans Saints last week. Exactly what happened down there?
Well, we jumped out to a quick 20-7 lead, and I felt like the defensively we just went to sleep. I felt lulled there in the fourth quarter, and we just couldn't get anything going. We couldn't stop the red wagon with biscuit wheels out there. it was bad, and that was the problem that I was hoping that we wouldn't get into with this ball club. We had to play our kind of defense out there.
You are quoted as saying you didn't think after you got out in front by 20 points, I think the score was 20-7 at one time, and the way your defensive unit has been playing, you thought that they wouldn't catch up.
Well, nobody has drove 90 yards on us for a touchdown. They're a fine football team, and I got to give Manning and Munson a lot of credit. They did an outstanding job on us, and you know, it looked like maybe on that Sunday, nobody probably could have beat them. They were hot, and we got a good defensive football team, not taking anything away from us, but they were hot, and you can't beat them when they're hot. I'd rather be hot than good anytime.
Claude, what were the feelings coming into today's game against a winless Tampa Bay club?
Well, looking at Tampa Bay, you figure they're going to have to beat somebody. Law average says somebody's going to come in here and not going to play right, and they're going to jump on them. And I was scared that it might be us after having that slump the latter part of the New Orleans game, and I think everybody else was afraid of that. That's the reason we played so well today.
Your week of practice, was it more intense, or did you go along just about the same way in preparation for the Buccaneers?
Well, our week of preparation was about the same. We didn't do anything, you know, out of the ordinary to prepare for this football team. We knew that we were going to have to come down here and play our usual defense and just get at them.
Are you looking at L.A. at all? Next week you take on a New England club that's been somewhat sporadic, but they have the capabilities of scoring a lot of points. Yet your club has not permitted more than 21 points to anybody for the 1977 season.
Yeah, we're looking forward to New England. New England kind of got to us during preseason, and I felt like we had a much better football team than they did, and the turf was slippery and bad. I'm not making excuses for a loss. They got to us during preseason, and we feel like we're a much better football team. So it's going to be a much tougher football game this time against New England than it was during the preseason.
Let's speculate just a little bit now. You've got a chance to meet Los Angeles head-to-head. They were winning the last time I saw the score 6-0 over Cleveland. Not knowing how it stands out, but you'll get a chance to either set L.A. back a ball game if you can continue winning. What are your thoughts there? Not to want to take you that far ahead.
I don't like to really jump that far ahead, but you know, L.A.'s got a good football team, but we beat L.A. Earlier in the year, and they're going to be shooting at us. We've never beaten L.A. out there, but we don't have any of the players that never beat L.A. out there, with the exception of myself. So it's going to be a whole different thing. And I feel like that we stand an excellent chance of really getting into L.A. and getting into them good.
What's it like playing with a young group of guys? The average age of your defensive line is somewhere around 22, 23 years of age. And you, at age 30, I'm sure it's considered to be an old man by many of the younger 22, 23-year-old guys.
Hey, they call me Pops. You know, 30-some years old isn't that old, but they call me Pops. I've been working with some of the young guys. I enjoy working with them. Those guys that we have on our football team are going to be the superstars of tomorrow. And I'm just happy that I can be around and help them and work with them and see the growth in the young guys. It's really beautiful. I guess it was that way when I came up, but, you know, it's different when you're on the other side looking down on them. Those guys are going to be super football players one day. I like to say hey to my mother in Memphis if she's listening.
Getting back to rehabilitating the knee, which has been probably the most feared injury in pro football and even collegiate and high school sports, what are some of the ingredients that one needs to get back the strong knee again?
Well, you're going to have a good trainer like Jerry Ray and Freddie Swacka, and you're going to have a coach like Marion Campbell who just stuck in there with me and stayed with me and believed in me the whole way. I was having a hard time. As a matter of fact, in this game, this was the first game that I played coming back off of the knee injury, and Marion Campbell stood in there with me, and I was having a rough day out here on this field. So, you know, you got to have the confidence of the coaches and the people who work with you, and you got to have confidence in yourself that you can get back. And I think it all stems around confidence. If you got confidence, anything can happen. The world is yours as long as you believe you can.
You had 18 sacks last season. I'm sure you're a little bit below that today, but there are a number of reasons, and I'm sure that you know and I know that there are a number of reasons why, say, a Claude Humphrey doesn't get 2 or 3 sacks per ball game. Dwell a little bit on that.
Well, for one reason, I play mainly over the tight end. Most teams figured out that if they put the tight end to my side, I'm going to go out there over him, and that means that I'm not going to be as effective pass rusher because I'm not going to get any kind of pass key.
Thank you very much. We've got run out a little bit of time. That's the way it happens here on the field. Now back up to Bob Costas.
All right, thank you, Em, and we're just moments away from joining Pat Summerall and Tom Brookshire in Washington for the Cowboy-Redskin game. That's coming up shortly. We'll be back after this.